Hey everyone, Art Burns here wishing you well. I got on my favorite brain t-shirt today to talk about a little bit of what happens in the brain during the stress response. And specifically, what I want to talk about is how stress impacts our memory. And here's a spoiler alert, it's not in a positive way. Okay. A lot of people don't realize the connection between our memory and stress, and I want to explain this to you because it's a really, really important thing that's going on every time you enter into the stress response. So the stress response, otherwise known as the fight or flight or fight, flight, or freeze state of the body, right, is when you're, again, as I talk about a lot, it's based on a fear that your brain perceives, right? And either it's an outer fear, like the screeching of a tire that you can't see, the smell of gas when you walk into a room, the heat of a door handle. You know, if the door handle's hot, or anything you touch is hot, you're immediately gonna freeze, right? Because you know that it's harmful. Before you can even calculate what's going on with any of these things, your body is going to either freeze, or it's gonna jump back, or it's gonna prepare itself to fight. And this all happens very, very quickly, and this is the stress response. Now, in the case of a hot doorknob or a hot pan that you're about to touch, or the case of a screeching tire, or the smell of gas, or any other things that you can think of, like the sight of a branch, a little stick on the trail that could be a snake, right? Any of these things, they represent present threats, right? And so this is where your stress response is really, really a positive thing for you, right? It's something that's really, really helpful, right? However, as I say here a lot, your stress can also be caused by the thoughts that you have and the memories that you have and the emotions that you have, right? And so this is where, of course, it's not a present threat, but your body doesn't know how to react in any other way except to put you into this stress response. So during this stress response, okay, very, very specifically, your body enters into a state of survival. Okay, meaning that the primary functions that happen during the stress response, the key ones are an increased heart rate, elevated blood pressure, it sped up a respiratory system, right? These three things that are specifically for the reason that your body is trying to get blood and oxygen into the big muscles of your body so that you can either run as fast as you can or you can fight off something that is going to hurt you, right? That's the point. That's the whole thing that the body's after. Now, in addition to those three active things, there's a whole bunch of passive things that happen in the stress response as well, okay? Among them, the digestive system shuts down, right? You are literally not digesting your food while you're in this, while your sympathetic nervous system is active and you're in this stress response, right? Even if it doesn't feel like crazy stress, even if it's just like a little bit, you're not digesting your food, right? Like literally your digestive system is shut down. Same thing goes for your immune system, your lymphatic system, your reproduction system, all the different systems of your body that are not involved with either fleeing or fighting or freezing in order to avoid harm from a present threat, okay? All of these things are shut down. Now, that brings us to this guy here, the brain, right? What happens in the brain when you're in this state, right? Because there's very, very significant things that are happening, right? Number one, your body, in general, the idea is that your body is devoting all of its energy to surviving, right? And so surviving the next 5 minutes of whatever is attacking you, right? Like, so think about, again, in modern society, the screech of a tire, right? That's something like a car accident takes seconds to happen, right? And so your body is just designed to survive that. No more than a few minutes, right? If you could picture a gazelle being chased by a cheetah, right? That chase and that threat only lasts for a few minutes at most, right? Because then either the cheetah gets tired or the cheetah catches the gazelle, in which case the threat is over or the gazelle is over in a matter of minutes, right? So that's the way your body and all these different systems are designed to shut down and to optimize yourself for survival for a very brief period of time. Okay, so again, back to this guy here, the brain, right? So what is going to happen during the stress response to your brain, okay, is that all the energy that's involved with all this brain activity, right, it's going to go pretty blank, right? Like there's no executive thinking during the stress response, right? Because remember, if you're, you know, the stress response is based on the very primal, very emotional center of our brains, right? It has nothing to do with figuring things out. It has nothing to do, like you know, if you're being chased by something, you're not calculating, okay, how fast is that thing really running, and how big are those claws that could, you know, no, you're instinctively, you're going as fast as you can. You'll figure it out later, right? That's the idea, is that you're figuring it out later. Most importantly, with the brain, the thing that is happening to your memory, right? There's a part of your brain that's right there in the middle. It's underneath all this wrinkly stuff that you see on this picture, right? And underneath there, you have what's called the limbic area of your brain, right? So that includes your amygdala, which is the fear center of your brain, which really is the initiator of the stress response. It also includes things like the insula, which is responsible for your body awareness and your awareness of your position in the world. It's a number of different things, but the one that's associated with your memory, right? The thing that is completely responsible for your memory is the hippocampus. Okay, so the hippocampus is this little area. Now, to be clear, your memories are actually stored in all this wrinkly stuff, right? Like when you make neural connections, that is what memories are. But for you to recall memories and for you to create memories, you need this thing called the hippocampus, okay? The hippocampus is this little thing right there in the middle underneath all this fluffy, you know, wrinkly stuff of the brain, right? And it's a little, you know, it's not that big. It's, you know, it's a little node in the body, right? And again, you could consider this kind of like a, almost like a thumb drive, right? So as you're experiencing things, right, and you're constantly storing things into the hippocampus, right? And then when you go to sleep at night, your hippocampus, you know, offloads all of that or uploads all of that information into these wrinkly, you know, neurons that make these connections, right? So that's how memory works, okay? Here's the thing though, right? And there's lots of data to support this, right? Lots of data that show that the hippocampus in people who experience chronic stress, which I love to repeat this statistic. I love it and I hate it. But the statistic is that 77% of American adults, okay, that's whether you're a business person, an IT worker, a call center worker, a parent, a stay-at-home parent, an ice cream vendor, whatever you are, right? You 77% of us deal with chronic stress, meaning that we're in the stress response every single day, which means also that's not stress that's derived from screeching tires and bears and snakes and all that kind of stuff. This is the stress that's involved with worrying about our 30-year mortgages, worrying about our car payments, worrying about our social status, worrying about our romantic status, worrying about our health status, right? Financial, romantic, social, health. Those are the four things that most people think of, and those are the four things that cause stress for most people, okay? So, lots of studies have shown that in those 77% of Americans who deal with chronic stress, meaning stress every single day, their hippocampi, right, is smaller. It's atrophied, okay? Because again, when you're being chased by a bear, right, the last thing you want to do is remember details about this, right? You're not taking in information, right? At that point, you are actually, in fact, the pupils dilate during the stress response because you're trying to let in as much light as possible because you're trying to get as much information as possible. So in fact, it's the opposite of what memory does, right? Memory is about taking in, you know, a limited amount of data, like filtering out some of the data so that you can remember the important stuff, right? So when you're in the stress response, when you're trying to flee something that's hurting you or about to hurt you, there's nothing to remember. Your brain is not worried about it, okay? Any more than it's worried about your immune system and catching a cold at that moment. Any more than it's worried about digesting your lunch, because that cheetah, if it catches me, it's going to digest my lunch just fine. Thank you very much, right? And so the idea is that you don't use your hippocampus, right? It's literally, it's taken offline. It's like taking the thumb drive and unplugging it from your computer, right? You literally are not using it. And so therefore, just like like any other part of your body, right? Any, you know, organ or any muscle of your body, if you're not using it, it is going to atrophy. Right, and that's what happens to the hippocampus. It shrinks, okay? It becomes less useful, less powerful, less effective, right? And so over years of chronic stress, this becomes, it's not permanent, thank goodness, right? Like there's actually been great studies done with people who have increased the size of their hippocampus. There's one very famous one done with a group of London taxi drivers, okay? In order to get a license to drive a black taxi cab in London, right? You people are known to study for 4 years to pass the test to get this license, okay? You have to answer, I don't know how many questions it is, but it's like an hour-long exam, and you have to give turn-by-turn directions to the proctor saying, okay, I'm starting you at this address, you're ending up with this address. You, without a map or GPS or anything, you have to give turn-by-turn instructions, and of course, you have to take the most effective way. And the city of London has over 25,000 streets. If you've ever been to London or any of those, you know, old European cities, you know that the streets are like all over the place. Some of them are one way, some of them are not. They're all, you know, it's mayhem. And so basically you have to memorize every permutation of every single, you know, route of 25,000 streets. I mean, that's staggering. So again, 4 years or more people are known to study to pass this test, right? And so they did a study of a group of these London taxi drivers controlled against, you know, people of similar demographics, similar ethnicity, similar, age and all that kind of stuff. And they found that the people who were the London taxi drivers who passed this, staggering, difficult test, these people all had larger hippocampi than the control group, right? So it's not like a permanent thing, right? So the more you can reduce your stress, the more you're going to give yourself a chance to get back all the memory. So let me ask you, I mean, you know, obviously you're not going to answer me here, but you might feel that if you are in a very stressful situation, if you identify with one of those 77% of the people in America who deal with chronic stress, you might find that you have a hard time remembering things, right? I know I used to. I used to have a terrible memory. I had to write every single thing down. Now, I remember everything. It's amazing. It really is. The difference is amazing. How much difference you can create once you lower the stress, you know, the stress response in your body, right? Now, let me be very specific, okay? While I still have a couple of minutes here, I don't want to take too much of your time, but you know, understand what I'm talking about here, okay? I'm not talking about reducing the stressors in your life, right? I'm not talking about getting rid of your kids. I'm not talking about, you know, quitting your job and weaving baskets in Vermont for a living. You know, I'm not talking about doing something that's completely different from the life that you have, right? Because stressors in life are inevitable, right? Because even if you do get rid of your kids, even if you do move to a rural place, like, I don't know why I said Vermont, but wherever, you know, and weave baskets for a living, anywhere you go, anything you do, whether you're in Midtown Manhattan or a cave in Tibet, you're going to have stressors in your life, okay? So it's not about, you know, just, you know, bailing out on your life and just getting rid of your stressors. The stressors are inevitable, but the stress they cause is completely optional, okay? So if you would like more information on how to reduce the stress in your body and increase your memory, which is very, very helpful in a lot of ways in life, of course, please get in touch with me. Drop a comment, send me a DM, reply to this email, wherever you're seeing this video. Get in touch with me and let's talk. I can give you some very simple practices that get you started, and I can coach you along the way to really ensure your success. Everybody, thanks for listening. I appreciate you. I wish you well. Be back again tomorrow.